So good morning. This is week number four of just strange and surreal. It's got to be strange and surreal for you. It certainly is for me as I look out on all the empty seats here. But I know we're together. We're certainly together as we pray together, as we pray with you, and certainly for you. We're together as we continue to struggle together through the new normal, which is COVID-19. Now, last week when I began my message, I mentioned that at that point last Sunday that 125,000 people in America had tested positive for the virus. This morning, as I come to you, 315,000 people have tested positive for this virus in America, and the numbers continue to go up at a rate of about 35,000 per day. Deaths continue to increase, as well as unemployment. Last week, 3.3 million people filed for unemployment in America. This week, 10 million people have filed for unemployment in America. And so as we look at the numbers, as we look at those becoming infected, as we look at the unemployment numbers that continue to increase, for some of us, we don't quite know what to do with that information. Within our own county, those who have tested positive for the coronavirus, the COVID-19 novel virus, has increased 80% since last week. We all together are being plunged into uncertain times. And as we seek God in this, I've got to tell you and encourage you toward an opportunity that I know God has put on my heart and God has put on many of our hearts. And the opportunity is this: these uncertain times will have a way of revealing some very deep, often ignored needs that we have left unmet, and that they will have a chance to propel us toward Christ in a way that many of us have not done in the past. And so within this crisis is an opportunity, and let me urge you and encourage you to dive deep into Scripture, to dive deep into the community that we have through the huddles. Talk to your huddle leaders, pray with them, pray with others. Try to find opportunities to reflect the light of Christ within the darkness of this new normal that we have. Now, today is Palm Sunday, and so today we begin Easter week, and this week we're going to be looking at the death and the resurrection of Christ, and today I want to look at a view from the cross, something that happens as Jesus is on the cross. I will come back, and on Thursday we will have a devotional together. Prepare communion, the elements in your home. Prepare to take the elements as I will lead into a devotional Thursday evening at 7 p.m. Our time zone here. And so join us with that. And then on Friday at 7 p.m. in our time zone, we will have a Good Friday devotional. And so I invite you to be a part of that, then looking forward to next Easter, which undoubtedly will be worshiping in our own homes and online like we are today. Now, today we're going to be looking at a passage in Luke chapter 23. If you've got a Bible or a Bible app, open to Luke 23. And I want to read verses 32 and 33, and then read verses 39 through 43. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be focusing on the two criminals that flank Jesus on either side of the cross. And so whenever you see pictures of crosses, you often see three crosses. For those of you that aren't familiar with Scripture, there's a reason why there are three crosses. And we're going to be looking at the reason today, because when Jesus dies, he dies flanked by two criminals. And he dies with one on his right and one on his left. And these two criminals both respond to Jesus, one of them with cynicism and anger, but yet the other criminal trusts his life to Jesus. And this picture of Jesus on the cross between two criminals is really the picture of our human condition. And I want to show you why, because we, every one of us, is like these two criminals. And so before we jump into this passage, let me give you point one. Every one of us, like these two criminals, number one, we are, like them, guilty. Like these two criminals, we too are guilty. Look at verse 32. There were also two others, criminals, led with him to be put to death. So here in the Gospel of Luke, Luke calls them criminals, but Matthew tells the story of these criminals, and he calls them by a different name. He calls them robbers in the NIV, or thieves, as it might be translated. And in the Gospel of Matthew, what we see is that Matthew tells us a bit more with the name that he gives them. The Greek word for robber is the word lestes, and this describes these two criminals. And in a sense, it was more than just thievery. What they would do is they would also, through any acts of violence, they would steal and kill in order to further their revolution. In other words, these were almost like ancient day terrorists, and they were now condemned to die for acts of terrorism. And by the way, there's one other person in Scripture who's called lestes, and his name is Barabbas, who was undoubtedly the leader of these two criminals and this criminal revolution that had been captured. And so here Jesus is taking his place on the center cross, I believe, that was meant for Barabbas. And Barabbas was released in Jesus' place, and he is now flanked by two criminals. Now, the Bible tells us that we are all criminals, every one of us, when it comes to God's law. The Bible tells us that we are all guilty. We are all guilty because of a sin that has infected, like a virus, the human race. Adam and Eve were created in the book of Genesis to walk and to talk with God in paradise. But what we see in Scripture is that when sin entered into the world, so did fear and selfishness and pride and anger, and within a generation, violence and godlessness that followed. Since sin cannot be where God is, what we're told in Scripture is that Adam and Eve were thrown out of paradise. They were thrown out of the Garden of Eden because sin was in them, and sin has been infecting the human race ever since. And so, like these two criminals, we also are guilty. Like these two criminals, we also stand condemned in our sin. But here is the grace of God. Jesus takes his place in the midst of these two criminals, and this is God's grace. He takes his place. He joins us in our guilt, even though he is innocent, taking his place between us, even in our guilt and condemnation. Many of us know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. But listen to verses 17 and 18 that follow. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. We were already condemned, but to save the world through him. And listen to what verse 18 says. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in him stands condemned already. And so here is the truth. Like these criminals, we too are guilty. Like these criminals, we too are condemned. Number two, like these two criminals, not only are we guilty, but we are also dying. Listen to verse 33. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. So like these two criminals, we also are dying. These criminals had hours to live, literally, before they would die. You and I have decades to live, maybe years to live. But nonetheless, we, like these criminals, are also dying. Ecclesiastes 7:2 says, death is the destiny of everyone. This is the destiny of all of us. You know, studies are in. 10 out of 10 people are going to die. We're going to die. Death is our destiny. Like these criminals, we will die. One of the reasons that COVID-19 has rattled us so much is that it's forced us to face something that we haven't wanted to face. Some people are terrified in facing COVID-19. Some people are literally terrified. Other people are in defiance and in denial, acting as if it can't harm them. But this is the way we face death as a human race. Some people are terrified. Other people are in defiance and denial when it comes to the reality that our days are limited, that we will have to face judgment. Many of us are in denial, but this pandemic, let's get honest, is causing us to think about something that we have long avoided, and that is our own mortality. You know, I have found as a pastor that people really are hesitant to talk about death, even on their deathbeds. I can't tell you how many times I've visited somebody on their deathbed and they've not wanted to mention death. They don't want to talk about it. It's almost like, I'm going to beat this thing. I'm going to beat it. In our culture, we have insulated ourselves against the reality of death. And we have insulated ourselves so much so that we almost in denial have pushed this aside. Listen to Hebrews 9:27. People are destined to die once, and after that to face judgment. It's not just death that people fear. It's also the judgment that comes after death. Now, interestingly enough, I've been able to talk with many people coming out of the occult. And people who have been active in the occult, in demonic type of activities, one thing is true of all of them. There is a great fear that they share of God's judgment. And I think the answer of why is because the closer you get to the demonic, the more you begin to dread what they dread. And Scripture tells us that the demons are terrified of God's judgment. That's, in fact, how they reacted when Jesus was around. They were terrified of it all. We as a culture have almost lived in denial, both of death, but also even a defiance or a dread of seeing God as a judge. But these three crosses give us a picture of the human condition. Every one of us is guilty. Every one of us is dying. Every one of us will face judgment, but here's the grace of God. Jesus has joined us in our death. And so like these two criminals on that cross, flanking Jesus, one on the right, one on the left, every one of us is guilty. Every one of us, secondly, is dying. Number three, every single one of us has a choice. Skip ahead to verse 39 with me. Then one of the criminals who were hanged there on the cross blasphemed him, basically rejected Jesus, saying, "If you were the Christ, save yourself and us." Now, don't you know this about suffering? And some of us are suffering, some of us more than others, through this pandemic. Don't you know this about suffering? Suffering will either cause us to become more softened or more hardened. But it will do something to us. That there's a story that's told of India in the 1930s with a missionary couple that was there, and they lost their child, and they were just grieving and almost beside themselves, not knowing how to interact, not knowing how to even face God since their child had been taken by death. And an older elder in the church, an Indian man, came to them and said, "Don't you know that suffering is like boiling water, and every one of us is either like a potato or an egg?" He said, "Every one of us is either like a potato or an egg, and when we go through suffering, we either like a potato become more soft, or like an egg we become more hardened." How will you respond to this time of suffering? Now, one criminal responded by becoming more hardened. The other criminal, we will see, responded by becoming more softened toward who Jesus was, even where he trusted his life to him. But the first criminal, he insults Jesus. He's so deep in his pain, and he's so cynical, and he's so hardened that even on his deathbed, literally, as he's hanging on the cross, even as he is dying, his heart is closed off. Now, I want to share something with you. Matthew tells us that both criminals started out here. Both of these criminals started out heaping abuse on Jesus. Both criminals started out hardened and cynical. Listen to Matthew 27:44. It says this, "In the same way, the robbers, the lestes, the revolutionaries, the violent revolutionaries who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him." And so at one point, as the evening began, both of these criminals are cynical and heaping insults on Jesus. And some people say, well, wait a minute, that's a contradiction. You know, Matthew's contradicting Luke. No, it's not a contradiction. It's a conversion. Something happened to this second criminal. Something happened to him as he watched Jesus die. Something happened as he heard Jesus say, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." Something happened during that period of time, and he became softened and trusted his life. Listen to verse 40. But the other, the second criminal, answering, rebuked the first criminal and said, "Don't you even fear God, seeing that you are under the same condemnation? Don't you even fear God?" He knows that Jesus has something to do with God. And he knows that Jesus is now under the same condemnation as they are, but he doesn't deserve it. He's understanding right now as he is on the cross, he's beginning to grasp the grace of God. And he's beginning to see something that no one else is able to see. And that's exactly what Jesus is doing right there on that cross amongst them. And he says, "Don't you even, while you were dying, have room for God in your life? Don't you even now? How can you be hardened?" He is saying to his criminal buddy, his accomplice. He says, "How can you be hardened at this point in your life, even as you were about to breathe your last? How can this happen? How can it be?" You see, he knows he's about to die, and he knows he's about to meet his Creator and face judgment, and he knows that he needs Jesus to be right with God. Listen to verse 40. "We indeed," he says, "are being punished justly," he says. "We are being punished justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And verse 42, undoubtedly you've heard this verse before. Listen to it. "Then he said to Jesus, 'Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom.'" Now, if you're taking notes, I want to mention to you three things about this criminal. Three things that he does as he trusts his life to Jesus. Because you and I, as we trust our life to Jesus, we need to do these same three things. And the first thing is this: he repents of his sin. He admits his sin and he turns from it. He says, "We are being punished justly. We are getting what we deserve." He's understanding that he is sinful, and he's turning his back on his sin, and he is turning toward Jesus in faith. He's repenting of his old life and now turning to Jesus for new life. This is what needs to happen with us. Now, there are many of us who may believe in Jesus, but let me get honest. You've never repented of your sin. You've never grieved the sin that has led to the destruction not only of yourself but others. You've never grieved not only the things that you have done, but the condition of sin that you're born into. And you've never turned your back on that. You've kind of said, "Jesus, I want you and that old life." To repent is to turn your back on something. And as he turns his back on sin, he turns his face toward Christ. Repentance is necessary. Now, if this is something you have never done, let me urge you, during this time of uncertainty, while the barriers and while the facades are down, to trust your life to Jesus. He repents. The second thing that he does is he acknowledges who Jesus is. Now, he makes three statements, or he hints to three statements about Jesus as he's discussing with this criminal accomplice of his. He acknowledges three things, and let me mention these. He acknowledges that Jesus is God. Verse 40, "Don't you fear God, seeing that you are under the same condemnation?" Now, he might not know all the theological intricacies, but he knows that this man dying next to him has something to do with God, and perhaps is. And he looks at him and says, "Don't you fear God? Don't you fear this man? Don't you fear God, seeing as how you are under the same condemnation?" He knows that Jesus is innocent. Verse 41, "This man has done nothing wrong." He knows that Jesus is a king and that his kingdom is not of this world. He says, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And this is huge. This is really big. And let me tell you how earth-shattering this is. He sees Jesus reigning not in power and in might, but in sacrifice and in death. Now, this is the kind of faith the second criminal has. He chooses to believe at a time when it appears that Jesus is helpless to save himself, and that's before Easter. He chooses to believe in Jesus as Jesus is dying, and he doesn't even yet know what's going to happen 3 days later. because there's something that he is convinced of about Jesus as he is hanging on the cross right there next to him. And in fact, notice this, he understood more than the disciples did. The disciples at this point are in hiding, thinking that the kingdom was over, that they would go back to fishing, thinking that the kingdom was over. But this guy, this criminal, he knows that the kingdom is just beginning. And he says, Jesus, remember me when you come in to your kingdom. So he repents of his sin. He acknowledges who Jesus is. And thirdly, he asks Jesus to save him. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, in the Old Testament, when God would remember somebody, it wasn't to think happy thoughts about them or to have fond memories. That's not what this is about. To remember somebody literally means to act on their behalf to save them. And so here's what this second criminal is asking Jesus. Jesus, would you act on my behalf and save me? Would you help me? Would you rescue me? I trust in you. Would you save me? Now here's number four. Like these criminals, we too are guilty. We too are dying. Like these criminals, we also have a choice. And number four is true of us as well. Like these criminals, we also can have salvation and assurance. You see, the difference between redemption and ruin, the difference between heaven and hell, comes down to one request. Jesus, I need you. I trust in you. Remember me. Save me. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. So how does Jesus respond to this criminal? Does he look at him and say, sorry, buddy, it's a bit too late, don't you think? You know, you're trying for one of those jailhouse conversions. I'm not into those, you know? Jesus doesn't say that. Does he look at him and say, you've made your bed, lie in it, or you've earned your cross, hang on it? He doesn't say that either. He looks at him and he says, you're in. That's it. You're in. You've asked, and now you're in. Listen to verse 43. And Jesus said to him, assuredly. And what he wants is he wants him to have assurance of this. Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Now, notice what he doesn't say. Now, Jesus doesn't look at him and say, okay, I'll save you, but first tell me what you did, and if it's not so bad, you know, maybe I'll let you in. You know, I want to see if you're worthy of what I'm dying to gain. He doesn't say that. Jesus doesn't look at him and say, okay, I'll save you, but first you need to be baptized. You know, and then after that, you're good. Or first you need to take communion, and then after that, you're good. Or he doesn't look at him and say, okay, I'll save you, but first go to my mother, Mary, who's there at the foot of the cross, and tell her to bring your request to me. He doesn't say any of those things. There are no hoops, there are no rituals, there are no acts that need to be done. He just asked in faith, and Jesus answered. You see, when it's all said and done, what gets us into this kingdom and what gets us into paradise is not our goodness. It's not our works. It's not our religion. It's not even our church. It's Jesus and our decision to trust in him. It's our repentance from our sin, our acknowledgement of who Jesus is, and our trust placed in him. So what happens when we die? You know, undoubtedly, as we're talking about death and as we're talking about COVID-19, and some of us maybe have thoughts in our mind of, okay, what's going to happen if I get this? What happens to me? Projections are that at least 200,000 Americans will die of COVID-19. I'm most concerned about people in the impoverished countries, quite frankly, where they cannot retreat, and they cannot find space, and they cannot social distance. You know, what's going to happen there? Understand this, though. What happens when we die? Does it all end there? You know, that there's the end of the line option, where some people think, okay, it all ends 6 feet under, it all stops there. Or maybe the next time option, reincarnation, you know, I'm going to come back, I'm going to have a second go of it. You know, what happens when I die? Some people think, you know, when we die, we stick around as a ghost and we haunt things like cemeteries and houses. I mean, what happens when we die? Understand these three truths about what happens when we die. Jesus makes it clear to this criminal who trusts his life to him. He says, today you will be with me in paradise. Let me explain that to you. When you and I die, immediately we are with God. Jesus says to him today, he says, truly I tell you this, today you will be with me in paradise. I tell you that the moment that you breathe your last, you will be in paradise. When you and I die, when we breathe our last, we are immediately with God. And we need to know that. And the second thing that he tells the criminal is this, you will be with me. When you and I die, we're not alone. We're not in some vacuum out there with nothing else around. We are with him. And then thirdly, you will be with me in paradise, a place that I have prepared for you. Now, I want to end here with paradise because we started here talking about guilt and sin. But the first time we see of paradise is the Garden of Eden. And this is a place where there is no death and there is no dying. And people walk and talk directly with God. And Adam and Eve are there in paradise. And they are in this place where they have full access to God. And death has not yet come into the world. And that was lost. And paradise was lost in Genesis. But understand that it was regained at the cross. The New Testament mentions the word paradise three times. It's the Greek word paradisus. It's mentioned here when Jesus tells the thief, today you will be with me in paradise. It's mentioned also in 2 Corinthians 12:4, where Paul says, I know of a man who was caught up into the third heaven. The third heaven is the Greek word paradisus. And you're thinking, well, what is the third heaven? Well, in the Jewish mind, the first heaven was the blue sky that you and I see at daytime. The second heaven was the starry sky that we can see at nighttime. The third heaven is beyond the starry sky. And he says, I got a glimpse into the third heaven. I got a glimpse into paradise, and I saw things that I cannot express. This person saw things they could not express in human words, Paul says. And the third time that the word paradisus, paradise, is used is in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. When Jesus says, the one who overcomes, I will give them to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of paradise. And so what was lost in Genesis is regained at the cross. And Jesus gives this criminal a promise, the same promise he gives us. And by the way, the night before Jesus died, he gave another promise, which was the same to his disciples when he said, in my Father's house there are many mansions, many rooms. I am going there to prepare a place for you, and I will come back and take you to be with me, so that where I am, you may be also. The bottom line is this. With Jesus, we have nothing to fear in life or in death. Jesus builds his home in us in life, and he prepares a home for us in death. Jesus wanted this criminal to be assured of his salvation. He didn't want to leave him hanging. No pun intended. He gave him the same promise he wants to give to us. So, we are in uncertain times. And in these uncertain times, many of us are shaken. Some of us are intimidated, and some of us are anxious. Others of us are in denial. But we are in uncertain times. How do we respond to these uncertain times? We look to Jesus by faith. We understand that every one of us is guilty. Every one of us is dying. Every one of us has a choice. But we each can have salvation and assurance. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I need what you came to give. I realize that I'm like one of these two criminals on the cross. I don't want to be hardened to the suffering around me. I don't want it to make me more hard, even though Scripture tells us that in the last days people will become more hardened to you, Lord God. I don't want to be one of those. I want to be softened. I want whatever I am going through and will go through to draw me closer to you. Jesus, I realize that I'm guilty. I turn my back on that. I recognize that I will have to face you one day as judge. I I acknowledge who you are as I turn from my sin. I know why you came. You died to take my place in death so that I might have a life I didn't deserve to have. And that is eternal life with you. Lord Jesus, allow this time of pandemic to be a time where we draw closer to you, but where we also see the culture around us draw closer to you. Allow us to be light shining in the darkness. In Jesus' name we pray together. Amen.